Thank you, Chief. Chairman Dinkman, faculty and fellow honorary freedmen, faculty, students, family, friends, welcome. Good morning to you all. First, I want to congratulate the students who are now being certified to be a scientist. Welcome to the guild. That's why we wear these silly looking things and hats, because guilds are famous for their regalia. I can only tell you about my experiences, and they'll be condensed into a few minutes. But I can assure you that you can look forward to exciting times as a scientist. You're going to have a good time. It's going to be rough. It's going to be tense. It's going to be competitive. You'll be taking paths you never thought you would take. But it will be exciting for you. If you like science, if you like to do research, which I like to do, you will have a good time. But I warn you, don't start writing your autobiography yet. I can tell you, I have 60 years of experience in science. I started graduate school 60 years ago, hard to believe. But I stand here today and I'm just amazed at how far science has come, particularly in the biological sciences, the biomedical sciences, how far it's come during the 6 decades. When I entered graduate school in 1958, the structure of DNA had just been discovered. The structure was published, and that was probably the biggest scientific event of the century, or perhaps several centuries. And I happened to learn about this while I was actually in an undergraduate school, and the beauty of the structure and what it dictated in terms of understanding life was it was something that you had to believe in, and it excited me, and that's how I got started in a career in science. So other than the structure of DNA, what else was going on? Not much. 1958, the genetic code was not deciphered, for one thing. What was called the central dogma, which was promoted by Watson and Crick and other scientists at the time, ruled the research, or dictated the research of many university labs. DNA codes, it gets transcribed, it gets translated, proteins are made. That was the central dogma. But it had to be proved. All the details had to be worked out, and it took many years for that to happen. The other area of investigation then was how genes were controlled, and how they were expressed, how they were controlled, on and off. I was fortunate enough to get introduced to a laboratory at the University of Pittsburgh to understand in a microbial system how genes could be turned on and turned off. It involved doing microbial genetics and biochemistry. And this particular project in this lab was the first example of positive and negative control expression. And over the years, the totality of that mechanism at a molecular level was unbelievable. And it had been written about a number of years ago in great molecular detail. In those days, we didn't have computers. Our computers were slide rules and really thick books of log tables. And compared to of all the knowledge that we have today and you have today, these were medieval times. So I got hooked on research, and in particular, I made an observation during my PhD research, and it caught my attention, and to the point that I wanted to know what was going on from these observations at a molecular level. And I carried that project with me to the University of California, San Francisco. And I arrived at UCSF in 1966. I took my first step on the academic ladder. And it's a pretty tall ladder, and sometimes it takes a long time to climb. Remember, 1966 was the summer of love in San Francisco. It's, you know, completely passed me by. And I didn't do it. But it's pretty interesting that people in San Francisco think they invented the summer of love. So I spent a number of years, several years, trying to understand this mechanism. Eventually we got to some biochemical and molecular understanding what was happening. It involved enzymes in bacteria to essentially recognize unique sequences in DNA, either toxin or methylated, very simple stuff. But I got together with Stan Cohen's lab and my lab, and we published the first recombinant DNA experiments in 1973. So this is 6 years, 7 years after I arrived in San Francisco. And it was a frantic time trying to use this technology to explore different biological interests and also improving the technology. And after several years of doing this, I was approached by a young venture capitalist in San Francisco, Bob Swanson. I was 39, he was 29. And he told me he'd been reading about this technology I was involved with, and he wanted to know if it could be used to start a company and make useful medical products. And so we got together and decided to start a company. He brought the money, and I helped with the science. And at the time, three technologies came together. It was DNA sequencing was becoming routine in the lab. And if you were lucky, you could determine the sequence of about 20 nucleotides. So you didn't have machines. It was all done by hand. The chemical synthesis of DNA was improved. There were several labs in the country. And I managed to get involved and do a collaborative experiment with people at the City of Hope, our greatest teaching at core, and we were able to introduce synthetic DNA into bacteria for the first time. So in 1976, with all this technology coming together, we decided to start the company. And at the time, I don't think I knew what I was really doing, but put together some scientists. And a lot really happened in the 10 years since I started at UCSF. So in 10 years, I sort of got to dabble in the business world. And biotechnology wasn't even called biotechnology then. So I viewed this as an experiment. It was combining business with science. And at the time, I thought, well, it's a nice experiment to do, but I'm not going to leave the comfort of an academic institution and go full time to the company. So I sort of worked back and forth between the company and the university for a number of years. And then I finally realized I wasn't doing research anymore, and I didn't like that. I liked to mess around in the laboratory and do experiments, maybe three or four at the same time, carry them out. So in 1991, I put away my pipettes and petri dishes, having reached the top of the academic ladder, and I sort of dabbled in the business world after that. I've been involved in a number of biotechnology companies. I still keep my eye on science by participating in the Scripps activities and being on the board. I don't know whether anybody knows this, but probably at least 40, 45 years ago, I was asked to come with a group of scientists to come and review the science Scripps research into. Frank Dixon was ahead of the research institute then. And I came down here and we reviewed what was going on. And look what happened. It was a good review. But I reflect back on those 60 years and all the incredible advancements. You know, when we were still working in the lab, someone approached me and said, we should sequence the genome of E. coli. I remember telling him, do you want graduate students to spend 24 hours a day sequencing DNA? And I said, colleague at Berkeley, and he said, no, it has to be done. And so I knew it couldn't be done by graduate students working in a lab sequencing endless pieces of DNA. But what made the difference was where there's a will, there's a way, and the invention of robotic sequencing that you use now without even thinking about it, that turned a corner. And so one of the milestones was sequencing the human genome by 2000. And an incredible achievement which has set off a huge wave in the biomedical sciences. So upon reflection, I realized that excitement in life is dictated by an unknowable chain of causality. And in your careers, you will come to binary decision points. Do I go this way? Do I go that way? What am I going to do? You have no idea. But it is exciting not knowing. And it should be exciting to realize that a lot of interesting things are going to happen to you in your scientific career. I look back at the last 60 years, I consider myself very fortunate just to have had a small part in it early in the revolution of the science. And I'm grateful to have lived long enough to see just the deep revelations that we have today on the complexity of life. And that's your challenge, to continue doing research and understanding the complexity of life. And doing so, you should help mankind, you should help yourselves. And I always thought that the most exciting part about being a scientist is if you ever make a discovery, and you're the first to discover something, and you realize that nobody else in the world knows what I know right now. The second most exciting thing in a scientist's life is the next day you go out and you tell everybody. So those are the 60 years of experience in science that I've tried to condense for you. And I appreciate having lived in what I consider the best of times. I think I have lived in the best of times. May you live in the best of times. Thank you.